Hello and welcome again to Southern Circuit. I'm Rickley Stone. He was once the official Queen's Piper, performing for such dignitaries as Golda Meir and President Kennedy. Today, Walter Wilkie has a new audience and a new reputation as Panama City's Lone Piper. Tallahassee's Senior Citizen Center has found there's a lot of untapped talent among our older citizens, so they've added a Center for the Arts to help do something about it. It all started with a Seminole Indian named Savage Sam. What's resulted is a successful business in gifts and accessories called Designs by Metzke. He's 82 and works in the nursery. She's 75 and weaves vases out of pine straw. He's one of the real McCoys. And together, they're some of the good folk we meet each week right here on Southern Circuit. An unexpected sight, a bagpipe player, fully uniformed, in concert, on a stand built just for him at a Scottish campground resort in Panama City Beach. But to Major Walter Wilkie, it's all part of his job at the KOA campground, where every afternoon between 4:30 and 5, the Lone Piper brings a wee bit of old Scotland to North Florida.
My parents had always wanted a bagpiper in the family, and when I was 9 years old, they sent me to this private college in Glasgow, Scotland, called the College of Piping. And they teach 6 nights a week from 6 o'clock to 10 o'clock, so I started studying there. And when I was 16 years old, I had my master's degree, and I kept studying, and by the time I was 20, I had a doctorate in bagpipes. I left Scotland. I was playing with different competition bands over there at one time. They travelled over Scotland and England, going to different Scottish gatherings and Scottish games. Then I was in the Queen's Guards at Buckingham Palace, and when you're in the Queen's Guards bagpipe band is the most widely travelled band in the British Army, because you're showing the colours of Queen Elizabeth, so you travel all over Europe, go to the British West Indies. I was in Africa for 2 years, Hong Kong, you just travel all over with them. You play at some neat places, you play at different houses of parliaments. Well, when you're in the Queen's Guard, you're at Buckingham Palace every day. Been in various big concert halls, you know, in Australia, and you see a lot of very interesting people.
Of the 22 bagpipe players in the Scottish Guard band at Buckingham Palace, Walter was selected to be the official piper for the Queen of England.
Queen Elizabeth just happens to really enjoy bagpipes. So she has a piper, plays outside her window when they're having breakfast. As they're supping their Wheaties or cornflakes or whatever, 9 o'clock in the morning, there's a piper playing outside the window. You play at lunchtime, you play at 4:30 in the afternoon, and you play in the evening if there's a state dinner. I played when John F. Kennedy was there, I played when Golda Meir was there, I played when President de Gaulle of France, Queen Beatrice of the Netherlands. When any foreign heads of state come to Britain, like visiting President Kennedy, for example, President Reagan, then this is part of the entertainment. The piper comes in while they're eating dinner and you play a selection of tunes and you leave and you go into the kitchen and the Queen chef gives you the same food as what they're eating next door. So you have something to eat, a bottle of beer, glass of wine, whatever. And about 20 minutes later, one of the servants comes in with a silver tray with a piece of paper on it. And it has a list of tunes that the Queen has asked all her guests what they would like the piper to play. Some of these tunes are just beyond belief, you know, Jailhouse Rock and Rock Around the Clock, stuff that you can't play on bagpipes, but you can't refuse to play it because the Queen would get very annoyed. She's very hard to amuse the Queen, so you've got to attempt to play them. When I resigned in 1965, I went back to Scotland. There was a lot of unemployment there at the time, and Syracuse University in Upper New York State was looking for a piper to teach at the university, and they got in touch with me and I moved to Syracuse University and I taught there for about 10, 11 years. Then I moved down to the outskirts of Baltimore and I was a piper for the British Embassy in Washington and I played for all the senators and at the Pentagon and just was really busy up there, very lucrative, a lot of money to be made, but I'd always wanted to move to Florida where the sun, I love sunshine. And the campground here got in touch with me and asked if I'd like to move down here, and I flew down here in March and liked the area and moved here on May the 16th. I've been here since.
Aside from being one of the finest bagpipe players in the world, Walter is also a licensed electrician, and that's how he spends his mornings at the campground. But his afternoons are devoted to Walter's first love.
I don't think I could go back. At times I think I miss it because London is just so much going on over there, you know, and when you're the Queen's Piper, you're recognised everywhere you go, you're on TV, you're on talk shows, you're getting photographed, you see your face on a poster for British Railroad, see Scotland by rail, and there you are, you know, and you're very well known, and then you kind of miss it at first, and then you just figure, well, I don't think I could never go back there to live now, though. America's my country, and fantastic.
Continuously seeking new ways of meeting the special needs of our senior citizens, Tallahassee's Senior Citizen Center is expanding, and the recent addition of their Center for the Arts is going a long way toward improving the quality of life in later years.
The Tallahassee Senior Citizen Center started 5.5 years ago, and with very few programs, with the meal program, which is provided by the Senior Society Planning Council, and maybe an exercise class and a few other classes around it, we had maybe, at the most, 40 to 50 people a day. We now have been open 5.5 years, like I said. We average, and we're open from 8 in the morning to 11 at night, Monday through Friday. We average 200 to 250 people a day here. So we've grown considerably, and people could come here and they could be involved in crocheting, in macrame, in portrait drawing, in art programs, in ceramics, in, we have a Florida and local history class taught by a retired history professor. We have sewing classes. We have the lunch program, like I mentioned before, is provided here. There's pool, there's puzzles, there's recreation, there's covered dish dinner and dances. And I believe the development of programming in any senior center across the state or across the country depends on the needs expressed within the center and from the senior community. We've responded to our need, and to a need that we felt was very important, and that was, you know, in the area of the arts. What was formerly a garage is now our arts center, and that has been renovated, you know, just beautifully, as people will see. And we feel we're very lucky to have a facility that we were able to renovate. And what the arts center has meant to us is a exciting new area of work that people want to be involved in to improve themselves, to become a better person. And I think that's a constant need within individuals, no matter what age. And that's what the Arts Center has done. It's provided a visibility to the center that a lot of people don't think of. People don't connect the arts and senior citizens. And it's as natural as anything else in life. And so it's allowed us a visibility that has also helped us try to defeat the stereotype of senior centers of growing old. People can be creative, they are creative, they strive to improve themselves individually. That doesn't change because someone becomes 55 or 60 or 65. Not at all. In fact, maybe it even strengthens.
I think it's the autonomy of it. It's one thing to be fed and fed and fed and have people brought in from the outside to feed you when you're sitting there. It's another thing to have your own thing and to operate it yourself and send out information or send out artworks or send out something from it. So the center in its own building with its own classes is going to be able to feed the community as well as receive from the community. And I think that's very important. See, I have a degree in art education. And so it was a natural thing for me to do. And I have a special interest in senior citizens. I'm getting a PhD in family relations, and I have a specialty in gerontology. And I'm interested in well-being and improving the quality of life, and I believe it can happen through the arts. One of the words on our sign is arts. Art refreshes Tallahassee seniors. And if it does anything for me, it revitalizes me. So for me, it's a wonderfully revitalizing and exciting program. It consists specifically of an oil painting class and acrylics in the same class, a class of drawing, figure drawing, and portraiture. So two separate visual arts classes. Then there is a ceramics ongoing class of 3 days a week. There is woodworking, and then there's fiber crafts like knitting, crocheting, and sewing that are ongoing here at the center as well. And then another thing we have is the calendar that we've put out. Okay, the Senior Citizens Art Folio has grown out of the 2 years of oil painting classes. And each of the pictures in the calendar was painted by one of the members of the art class.
The calendar has been a reflection of, I believe, the interest in the arts, and has allowed us to work on having an arts coordinator here at the center. Marcia Dooley is now the title as our arts coordinator, and her interest is in the expansion of arts and craft programs within the arts center.
Yes, I want to grow. I'd love to be able to offer pottery classes in our ceramics program. That'll take a while because it needs a lot of equipment and time. I would love to have an evening of the arts once a month with slide presentations from the National Gallery and some string quartet or some classical music, and round out an evening and have it here in a chamber music sort of setting. We would like to have some art exhibits. We've already had a selling fair where we've sold our works. We would love to do some intergenerational things and send seniors out to teach art in the schools, or to have children come in and have seniors work with them. I'm really hoping we can do something intergenerational. I would love to do some improvisational drama with them as actors.
We're very lucky to have that, and have a person who not only is aware and sensitive to the needs of older people, but of the artistic needs of all individuals. And I think you're going to hear a lot from her and a lot from the senior artists of this community.
Football can do strange things to people. Take Dr. Fred Metzke, for instance. For 20 years, he was a professor in art at Florida State University. An avid football fan, he designed a pin for Coach Bill Peterson. The pin was of a Seminole Indian. Its name, Savage Sam. That was in 1964. What's followed is a success story, not only for Dr. Metzke, but for the entire Metzke family.
We do gifts and decorative accessories. We do desk sets, candle accessories, votives, jewelry, gourmet, just general accessories.
We're located out in the country a little bit, on about 5 acres, and we've designed the plant to give the employees a little something extra besides just, you know, a place to work. We have picnic tables, basketball court. It's just kind of a nice setting. It's a rural setting, and it leaves us a lot of room to expand. And we're very close to Gadsden County, which where a lot of these people come from. So it's a little different setting than just a factory in the middle of a city.
Different indeed, the family-run business located on Metzke Lane off Capitol Circle Northwest manufactures thousands of gift items sold throughout the United States, England, Canada, and the islands.
Mother has the idea, and she turns it over to Dad, who's the artist. and he'll take the idea and put it into the hard copy, into the metal from the drawing, and then Dad will turn it over to the mold maker. The mold maker takes his first original piece and makes a copy of it. And then from that one copy, we make our production molds, where we get hundreds and thousands of pieces. And that's basically how it works. And I guess the end product is, and then we give it to little brother, and my sister has her retail shop, and she relays right to the public, where we deal mainly just wholesale here at Designs by Nelson.
I think it's a very wonderful combination. Fortunately, I have a logical mind, which enabled me to do production, and I love, you know, a logical problem or something that has a good answer to it. And then on the other hand, intuitively, I have a gift for art. I can't tell you why it's good. Now he can, but I can't. And therefore, acting as the entrepreneur and the developer of new products, it's just a very wonderful combination. Because not only can I say, you know, oh, let's do that cheese mouse, and I figure out the function for it, then also I can say, Fred, we need a little whimsical mouse. And he produces the design.
This, to me, is I can do my own thing, and that I do it for everybody. I'm making it for other people.
He's an extremely talented person. He can design a house, a piece of furniture, a piece of jewelry, anything, needlework, anything that he decides he wants to do. Like all artists, though, he has to want to do it. I can't tell you how many thousands of pieces that he has designed. He works in the medias of wood, gold, silver, or pewter, but now only with original designs because his time is so valuable. I don't think of it so much as working with my son or my husband. I guess that's the first thing we had to get straight. One is, as soon as they step over that threshold, I'm not their mother and I'm not his wife. And that if I have to answer to the corporate attorneys, then they have to answer to me. So sometimes it could get a little difficult, especially when Fred does a design and he says, you know, this is it. And I look at it and I say, no. And then, you know, he sags and it's back to the drawing board. Because artists have a tendency to think that everything that they do is great. And 90% of the time, it may be. But when you're working to meet the tastes of the average person, you've really got to work it down to where it is. Sometimes the design is too sophisticated for them and it won't sell.
These pieces are produced in rubber molds, and the molds have cavities. It's done with centrifugal casting. The metal is poured through the top of the mold, the mold's spinning, the metal fills the cavity. We have the FSU Indian pin here. All right, the pieces are removed from the mold, and then the center part's recycled. And these molds have to be replaced periodically. We manufacture about 1,500 different products here at Designs by Metzke, so each caster will work on maybe 20 or 30 different products during the course of the day. So he'll work one mold, put it at the back of the line, cycle another one, and keeps the molds warm. Inside the factory, after the pieces have been cast, they'll be cleaned. We have a mechanical method of cleaning the part. They're glued, some of them are glued, some of them are soldered. The final step is the highlighting. Each piece is hand antiqued, and that step requires a lot of artistic talent to do that. And then after the antiquing process, it's packaged and warehouse for distribution.
All of us work together in the family with our employees, and our employees actually run this company. When they get into trouble, they come to us and we help them, but it is actually run by a council. They set their own wages and hours and do their own reprimanding. So it's worked out very well. I think we were probably Japanese before the Japanese were.
I guess my greatest hope is that it would continue to serve its people, its community, and its buying public, and that the people who are part of it should enjoy it, and it always be safe, pleasant to work here. Those would be my hopes for it. You see, the money from Designs by Metzke was a byproduct, because we were all too busy working, thinking of our health and employees' health, safety, designing a good operation, and new products. And that's the way it should be. That's very important. If you do all those things and do them right, you can't help but make money.
Myrtle and Irvin McCoy are what you call good folk. They spend their time minding Mariana's old and rare bookshop, a kind of junk and treasure store owned by Irvin's son-in-law. And they tend to their hobbies. Myrtle weaves pine straw into vases, and Irvin grows plants. He's also a descendant of the famed West Virginia McCoy family and shared with us what it's like to be one of the real McCoys.
I was a little bit too young to have much to do with it myself. But my Uncle Frank and Uncle Tom and Uncle Emery, all three of them fought in that all the way through it. They killed several Hatfields, and the Hatfields killed several McCoys, too. And it all started, the Hatfields stole a bunch of hogs. They let their hogs run wild out in the woods. They'd eat acorns in the fall of the year and fatten up. And Hatfield stole two or three or four of them and had a big supper, and they invited the McCoys down for supper to this party or banquet they had. And then they told them about taking them hogs up there in the woods, and that they was McCoy's hogs, and made them mad. They got into a fight and started shooting each other. And that's how it started. That's the truth. And it went on for about 7 years. And there was 37 people killed in that feud. It was a regular feud. Finally ended some way. The McCoy boys got to marrying the Hatfield girls. Then they took the fight in the home, so they had ended it out in the woods, and they fought at home from then on, quit shooting each other, and went to raising families.
Well, he runs a little nursery out there, and he stays at the trail and listens to television some, and sells flowers. It's sort of a hobby with him. He don't make much.
I go to bed at night, you know, and I think, well, let's see, got to get up in the morning and pot them flowers, and I got to change this and change that, and keeps my mind busy all the time. Gives me something to do, something to think about. And I enjoy working with the flowers and shrubbery. And I was a farmer the biggest part of my life.
Well, I like to stay in here because it belonged to my brother. He built the store. It's out of poured cement. It's not blocks, it's poured. One day, somebody come in and looked so like Johnny Cash. You know, he's a Cherokee Indian. And a man came and looked just a little older than Johnny. And he got to walking around, and I said something about Arizona. And he said, well, I'm a full-blooded Cherokee, and I'm a missionary Cherokee Indian. And he said he was going to go on the globe and teach some in a school there, teach the Indian children. And then another time, a lady came in here, looked like Loretta Lynn. And I didn't say anything to her at first, but she came up close to looking at some books, and I said, you sure look like Loretta Lynn. And she says, yes, says, I'm full-blooded Cherokee. Says, I'm from up around Knoxville, but I've lived here now a year or two in Jackson County. And she looked like Loretta Lynn. Loretta Lynn, you know, is Cherokee. My grandmother was full-blooded Creek, And on my father's mother's side, my grandfather was part Cherokee, but I don't know how much. I have the papers on the Creek, you know, showing that I am Creek from the government. About 50-some-odd years ago, when we lived in South Florida, my father's running a little sawmill, and they cut the pines down, and the straw turned pretty and brown, you know, where the tops, and we got, my mother and me and another lady got out and got us some and decided we'd try something. We made us some little flat baskets. And after that, then after I come up here, I started the vase business. Went on up with it. Well, it's just something, something for Florida, because especially Northwest Florida. Now, South Florida has the palm, the palmettos they make hats out of. It's beautiful, because we've had some of them. And then they make shells and all kind of pictures out of shells. But up here, we don't have too much that way, handmade stuff from Northwest Florida. And there's so much pine straw here, it ought to be used for something, besides just putting it in the yard or around azaleas or something. I've been learning there all of them I could how to make them, so they can make them a little something and just have a pastime. It's real nice. You can sit and watch television and just work on it real nice.
You'd be surprised how many of them she's really sold. She's got a book in there she puts down where all they go. Man, they've been in pretty near every state in the Union and several foreign countries. All I have against them is that she don't charge enough for them. She should charge more, really, than what she does. Them big vases, she'll work a week on them, she ought to get more than $5. If she gets seven, it'd be all right.
I'd hate to get more than that for one. If I was going to buy one, I'd like it cheap as I could get it.
Men down here at Western store, they come in here and give her a dollar piece for them smaller vases. They take them down there and sell them for $5. She ought to get two for them. I try to tell her that, but she just won't listen. She says, oh no, she ain't gonna overcharge anybody.
We don't get rich, either one of us. It's just mostly, we just go and enjoy it.
That's Southern Circuit for this week. Thank you for being with us. Next week, Southern Circuit will be on the road while Channel 11 brings you the WFSU-TV auction. But we'll be back the week after. We hope to see you then. Good night.